point that I wanted to make, which you reminded me, Val, was that it's not just the people part, but the whole dance idea is people is one aspect, but to really truly understand what complexity is and the people and how they behave and interact in a system, because a project is like a complex adaptive system. So there's three things typically that increase complexity, right? Or that define complexity, which is, it's the first, the number of people or the number of monkeys, so to speak, in your project, you know, stakeholders, right? So the multiplicity of intricacies and overlaps between three things that we need to understand, which is people, obviously, and, you know, how they behave, but also how they are connected to each other and how the information flows through them. So, for example, you know, you may understand your piece of the project very well, right? And you are working very hard to deliver on those pieces. But what really often gets us is how it interacts to other areas of your organization. And, you know, all of a sudden it goes haywire, right? Because we don't understand that we are part of a larger complex adaptive system. So what I'm saying is, yes, two things. It's the people, plus also we need to understand the complexity and the connections and the information that flows through them, besides the behavioral part.
Yeah, I absolutely agree. It's something I've found is more interesting now studying business psychology, in that there's more of an element of this softer side of working that's required. And I was just on finishing my thought before, it was basically observing your book from the top down. I think the fact that you included design thinking, and that in essence that is a non-linear process itself. What's your definition of design thinking? Because you mentioned it a few times in the book, and obviously there's a few methods you've pulled out, but you've combined them quite well. How does design thinking apply to projects in PMO in the next generation?
And that's great, because there's a lot of stuff out there now on design thinking, and even, you know, we do a lot of design thinking workshops and so on. So it's kind of similar, you know, it goes to the whole empathy part and understanding your user and customer. But the way, you know, I approach it in the book, and more from a project management standpoint, it's all of that, but a slightly different angle. So let me give you an example. And one of the big takeaways for the, for project managers is this: to distinguish between planning versus design. Okay. To distinguish between planning versus design. And I forget what chapter number it is, but I get into a lot of details in that chapter. But here's what I mean. Is planning is typically more what I would say an engineering approach, okay, which spells the details and provides a mechanism to execute the vision, right? So it's like almost like, if you think about in a project plan, your work breakdown structure is like the details and the specifications. Now, what's interesting is you would not build a building, right, without a blueprint, typically. Right. But guess what? A lot of project managers do that. They build, you know, they start to kick off the project without a blueprint. And what I mean by that is a design, okay, an architecture approach. So the key is to distinguish between an engineering approach versus an architecture approach. So what's an architecture approach? An architecture approach is that as a project manager or program manager, you focus first on the form, the function, and the structure to ensure the feasibility and viability to enable the vision, right? So as an architecture, first you're saying, what's the foundation? What's the structure? How does it look like? Before I get into the details of the work breakdown structure where I have to execute. Now, automatically when you're doing it, you're bringing in a lot of the systems thinking ideas and so on, right? So the way there's a whole, you know, approach we talk about in our seminars and so on, where they used to try to connect your OBS, your organizational breakdown structure, with your PBS, your product breakdown structure, and your WBS, your work breakdown structure. And then you kind of ask yourself, how do I design? One of the things that comes to mind when I talk about this is I always wonder, right, when I'm flying in a plane, although I don't know when that's going to be the next time around, you know. Literally, I live on planes, you know, going all over the place. And in the last few months, you know, you can't even think about it anymore, right? I hope it's going to be soon. But anyway, I often wonder when I'm sitting in a plane at 35,000 feet in extreme temperatures with extreme turbulence, of how can the plane withstand all that? You know why? Because it's designed for it. So the question we as leaders in organizations, as executives, as project managers, as program managers have to ask is, how do I design my project, my team, my organization to withstand the turbulence, right? Mm. There is a quote from Roger Martin, who's the dean at the Rotman School of Business in Toronto. And he said that, you know, he said this, the design thinker has a stance that seeks the unknown, embraces the possibility of surprise, and is comfortable with wading into complexity and not knowing what is on the other side. So that's exactly what we're going through in COVID right now, right? So what I added to that is that design is more suitable to withstand the dance, right? So in a situation where there's a lot of uncertainty in our projects right now due to COVID and so on, right? Instead of focusing more on planning first, I would focus on design. And you will see in the book, there's a whole table which goes into this distinction and explains it in a lot more detail. I just gave you the highlights of the distinction between design versus planning. Now, again, please, please don't get it the wrong way. I'm not saying planning is a bad thing or you shouldn't do it. You should, of course. But before we dive into planning, we have to think about design or see how I can balance both of those aspects.
Yeah, that's really interesting, Jack. Just while you were chatting there, it took me back a bit when I think Val and I had lots of conversations and we worked around, you know, projects, teams, environments, just, you know, execution, the works. And something that I often come back to is, you know, being a avid sports fan myself, is how all the top sports teams in the world have a strategy that can fit and change and be agile depending on how the match progresses during the match rather than an afterthought. And some of the questions you go on, well, if you only have one plan, well, you're not going to be a successful sports team. So how can you be a successful project delivery team, you know, if you're only going with one approach? Equally, you know, more and more these days, if we use that analogy with sports teams, they have bench capacity where they have people with different skill sets that they can then bring on should the need arise. And you know, this constant drive by organizations to be lean and you know, cut down on costs and not have wastage and things like that kind of hinders that from my perspective. So I don't know how much that will sort of resonate with others out there or not, because, you know, not everyone's into their sports, but I thought that certainly resonated with me, you know, when you were chatting about, you know, things are thought out from the beginning for all eventualities.
Sports is a very good analogy for where we want to go, because it is very much, you know, the way nature works, right? When we try to, you know, apply organic ways, it's very much like that. What I mean by that is spec versus SRA, which again is the whole idea of, you know, how do we get to that next generation, which I'll talk about in a minute. But speaking about planning, you reminded me of something. Somebody sent this to me, you know, recently, and I got a big chuckle out of it. It said something like, the most useless purchase of 2019 was a 2020 planner, right? We all had plans and look what happened to them, right?
Yeah.
Because they were, you know, sort of the linear, you know, fixed plans, and then the game changed, you know, to go back to your sports metaphor. So so here's the big distinction, right? Over the last 100, 150 years, the way we run business, organization, factories, projects, is I could summarize it in four letters, right? Which is special.